Good evening and welcome to Artist Talk on Art. No kidding. April 1st, 2024. I'm Doug Scheer, president. This is our 50th anniversary year, and we're holding a gala celebration on Monday, May 20th at the Soho Photo Gallery and an online auction that starts April 27th and runs through May 22nd. We're seeking art donations for that fundraiser. To order tickets and to make art donations, go to our website, www.atoanyc.org, and click Buy Tickets for Tickets and Donate Art to enter your art and upload an image. When you do, you'll be joining over 80 artists who have already done so, so you're going to be in great company. All ATOA Zoom events like this one tonight are copyrighted by Artist Talk on Art and go next to our YouTube channel, usually in the next day, and later, ultimately, to our own archive at Archives of American Art of the Smithsonian Institution. We'd like you to hold your questions and comments until later on, like near the end, or you can plug them into the chat feature of Zoom at any time. Now about tonight's panel. I've known all three of tonight's presenters for more than 40 years. I say that with no embarrassment.
But none of us are that old.
Right. We were all babies at the time.
That's right.
They all came to my attention originally in the late 1970s when they tilted at the Whitney windmill, which was called the Biennial. They came together, and others too, to create another view of contemporary art called the Whitney Counterweight. Tonight we'll hear more about that project, perhaps maybe be better to call it a protest movement. And invariably, they're going to tell us more about themselves too. In fact, they can't be prevented from doing that.
No.
Vernita Nemec served as director of Artist Talk on Art, interviewing art world luminaries and creating evenings of artists presenting five minute performances. In 2001, she became and still is director of Viridian Artist Gallery in Chelsea. She has independently curated exhibits since 1994, first at Henry Street Settlement Art Center. She has continued to independently curate extensive group exhibitions of art from recycled materials entitled Art from Detritus, for which she has received numerous grants, including a Kauffman Foundation grant and a Puffin Foundation grant. She also organized one of the first feminist exhibits in 1969, X-12, and in 2022 co-curated an exhibit of New York City women artists from the 70s who are still making art, shown at the Carter Burton Gallery in Chelsea. Nemec completed her BFA cum laude at Ohio University, receiving an NDEA grant to finish her master's work at New York University. Since then, she has presented more than 30 solo exhibitions of her visual art and over 60 performance artworks, receiving grants from the Jerome Foundation, Artist Space, Franklin Furnace Fund for Performance Art, Movement Research at Judson, The Field, Artist Space, NEA, and others. Her visual and performance art has been presented in the US and in Mexico, Hungary, Germany, Japan, Ireland, and France.
I love to travel.
Obviously. She continues, or rather her recent art has been environmentally motivated, first creating art from junk mail and currently sculptural works from plastic discards, which she will be presenting in a solo exhibit in February 2024.
It happened.
Oh, it happened, right. Okay. Bill Rabinovitch, who we hope will join us sometime soon, makes art that reflects a process of spontaneous invention and poetic feeling while exploring the potential of great color. An expressionist artist in Soho since the 1970s, he's also a feature film and art documentary maker. He created a 20-foot mural, which is permanently installed in the Canal Street Post Office. Bill created original TV plays on Picasso, Basquiat, and a major documentary on James Rosenquist. A mechanical engineer, he graduated from Worcester Polytechnic Institute and was a jet pilot in the Air Force. He also has worked with NASA. And I will mention that there's an interesting, I think we may be playing part of it tonight, an interesting new interview done by Ben Aaron of Bill. And I have to say, I liked it. Barnaby Ruhe lays claim to being one of the last living members of the first generation of abstract expressionists. You know, Barnaby, the other members of the first generation were all born in the before World War, before or during World War One. So
yes, it's a miracle.
You're either Methuselah or because you're more of my generation. So
yes.
But if you think you're a first generation member, mazel tov.
Yeah, right.
I can explain.
No, save it. I'm saving it until I finish this. Okay. He was a two-time United States Naval officer during the Vietnam War. Was that two tours? Okay. As well as a historian, Ruhe has been teaching shamanism and art at NYU for the past two decades, where he earned his PhD. He served as the senior editor of Art World newspaper from 1979 to 1999, and also in 1979 created the Portrait Painting Marathon and Salon de Guerre.
Oh yeah.
He muscled the Whitney Counterweight in 1977, 79, 81, and 83 alongside Bill Rabinovitch and Vernita Nemec, and with the help of an NEA grant. He is a recipient of both a Pollack Krasner and the Mid-Atlantic NEA Award. Ruhe's artwork is included in the collections of the Museum of Modern Art. Jack Lang, is that the French culture
yes,
minister?
Yes, French no. culture minister, yeah.
Judd Tully, Cindy Adams, and Bob Metzger?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, and others. Okay, folks, you're on, and let's hope that Bill makes an appearance.
Vernita, let's pass it over to you to discuss the extraordinary origins, probably in 76, late 76, of the Whitney Counterweight. What the hell were we thinking?
Well, the thing is, I don't really know. But I think that as well, actually, in one of the Whitney biennials after the Counterweight had been over and done, I was approached by Italian TV and I had my hair all screwed up and they said, gee, what do you have to say about the Whitney biennial? And I said, it's the show we love to hate. And I think they've repeated that, you know, many, many times. And I think that was maybe how I got my job at Veridian initially, was having the courage to say that in America on Italian TV. But a precursor to all of that, as Doug mentioned, was Art Workers Coalition meeting at Museum in the early 70s and the late 60s gave us opportunities to present exhibitions. And one day, another woman, an artist, and I stood up and we said, okay, the first 10 women who are willing to stand up and say they are women artists, not pretend they're men artists, which we had to do then to get a show, can be in this exhibit. And so we called it X12. And I think that was one of the first all-women shows that happened during this current art period. And out of that group of women, two of them were the organizers of Soho 20 Gallery, which was one of the first all-women art galleries. You know, I could say a lot about all the things that women did, but the Counterweight was about much, much more than that. What we were rebelling against was the fact that almost all the artists that the Whitney showed at that time were from five blue chip galleries. And we said, wait a second. And that was when Bill and Barnaby and I said, we're going to do something about this. Right, Barnaby?
Yeah, we actually were thinking, How did they find the artists? They went to cocktail parties at the gallery. There's an artist. So let's put him in the show. The idea that nobody's going to studios. There's 10,000 studios in New York City, and everybody's got going to the 300 galleries, which are providing them with the luxury goods they require to salivate onto the art world, which isn't the same thing as the art world, by the way. The art world, it turns out, includes other artists. I think that, you know, as we know, there's Salon de Refusé, Manet organized a group in the Tuileries, and they had a little show there. And I think that spirit is quite remarkable because it's necessary. The Digglers have a thing called branding. They just need to keep the artists in line, looking like what they're supposed to look like. And they can't have too many artists because they don't have too many collectors. So the whole thing's really carefully arranged, which isn't the same thing as what's happening in the art world. The art critics, of course, do the same thing, where they seem to find the artists in the gallery shows, which isn't the same thing as looking for them in their studios.
And I think the exact opposite of, didn't we, Barnaby, that a lot of the artists we knew, we asked to see their work, then we asked them to recommend more people whose art we could look at. And then finally, we did a real curatorial madness. It was very difficult in trying to make sure that we covered all the bases, I think, stylistically. And even when we didn't try to, it happened that we got a lot of women. We got a lot of people of all nationalities and colors. We got
the demographics. It was accidentally perfect, because when we went down in 77, Jimmy Carter was just elected president, had not been inaugurated. They had these ugly Quonset huts that were housing the president, including before the inauguration, including his art czar, Judith Schwartz, which was really extraordinary, because who the hell knew that he had an art czar? We drove down to Washington, D.C. And in early January 77, and we bopped into Judith Schwartz's office, which was the funniest thing. Now, in the meanwhile, I was a Navy lieutenant, just got out of the Navy in 75, and I'm looking at this situation with Vernita and Elizabeth Converse and Bill Rabinovitch, and these guys are idiots. You know, they're like, they've got this crazy idea of going after the Whitney Biennial. We got no money, no galleries, no ideas. We just know that it has to happen. So then Bill says, I think it was Bill who said, let's just go down to D.C. and get some money. And I think, that doesn't happen. You know, I was a Navy lieutenant, so I was an organized, rational human being, and this whole thing looked stupid. But I drove the car, and we went down there, and we talked to Judith Schwartz, and she said, oh, hello, darlings, it's so nice, you know, to see you. We said, we want to do a show against the Whitney Biennial. She said, sure, why not? So then we walked directly over to Jim Melchert over at the National Endowment for the Arts, and we put a little note to his secretary saying, we just saw Judith Schwartz, and we'd love to see you now. He freaked out, because who knew that Jimmy Carter, the new president, had an art czar, and we just talked to him. So he was actually kind of intimidated, let us in, and within 15 minutes wrote us a $15,000 matching check. On the rumor that we had seen Judith Schwartz, little realizing that she had said, darlings, good luck, but she hadn't done anything for us. But it was enough leverage, enough blackmail to get us this check. It was really funny, because as we drove back, it's a little anecdote. We're in the car, driving back from DC with complete success. I couldn't believe it. I'm proud of myself, even though I told them, don't go down there, it won't work, you know, the whole thing. And we're talking to Arnold Wexler, another great artist from those years.
Who did so much organizing of artists and helping of artists too.
Well, guess what he did? So he went down with us. And he was wearing a sharkskin suit and a really loud tie. And he looked like a used car salesman. And he's kind of like a maybe Asperger's or something. He just had a kind of spectrum disorder. He just had a very shy, strange way about him. And I thought, and he left us, and he's in the car, and we're driving back. And I said, well, we just got the $15,000. Arnold, what did you do in D.C.? He actually went separately. He just hitched a ride with us. And his idea was to go talk to the congressmen in America and ask them some questions. So he comes back and he says, well, you know, the congressman decided to give me 90,000 square feet of raw, unused federal office space in Manhattan, New York City, for the OIA, the Organization of Independent Artists. I mean, then I'm going, Arnold Wexler, I guess he took us out, you know. I thought the guy was, you know, I didn't think this was serious what he was doing, but he ended up with about 10 or 15 years of 90,000 square feet of used office space, spare office space for artists in New York City. It was an enormous coup.
And the Counterweight had five galleries in which we were able to present over 100 some artists. And exactly. Alain Billot Gallery, a French dealer, Nilda, the Hispanic gallery was another gallery, Bill Rabinovitch Gallery. There were two on West Broadway. I don't remember their names now. It's terrible.
The James Yee Gallery, I think it was. James Yee, something like that. So Korean. But so what was really exciting about this was, for some reason, spring broke miraculously on March 15th of 1977, after an awful winter, a severe winter. Suddenly it was like 70 degrees, sunny, and we'd gotten some reviews in the New York Times, etc., because of the outlandish claim that we were going to take on the Whitney Biennial, which of course was, you know, like tilting at windmills, as Doug Shear has noticed. And 15,000 people showed up curious about what was happening. Peter Frank was one of our champions and art critic now in Los Angeles. He gave us some good looking breaks. The word got out. It was really an astonishing 15,000 people showed up on the first day. It was a great spring day in these five galleries and so on. And what happened was really astonishing. I got to tell you, we had 100 artists selected out of 4,000 entries, a lot of slides. We did so much good looking politics. I think it was Gil Coker and Randy Williams, these two artists who joined our executive committee, and they basically counseled us with a lot of maturity to use slides that did not have any names on them. We would then not know who were women and who was Black and Hispanic and whatever the breakdown was, and the slides would be anonymous. And then we had the selection committee was a couple Blacks, a couple Hispanics, a few women, a couple men, all mixed up. And I got booted out of the slide thing because I was not making the demographics. So I said, I'll be the slide shower. I will work the slides. So I got to make little comments that might have helped at some point. In any case, what happened there was, sure enough, 52% of the people, the demographics were perfect. 52% were women, 20% were Blacks, 18% were Latinos, whatever. The demographics were remarkable. And then the quality was good. But what also happened there, by the way, was we knew that we had people like David Hammons, Wopo Hollop, and
Joan Semmel.
Joan Semmel. We knew we had some really great people that could come in. And we knew that David Hammons was a sweetheart. What we did do is we put a guy like Hammons in the front row center of a good-looking gallery space. Not a guy with the big shows at the time. We had at least five artists, including Leon Golub and Nancy Spiro, get their first big shows, as well as David Hammons, I believe, get first big shows after our museum show. They finally got into some, they cracked into some galleries. There was some good movement doing. We literally did some muscle. And I think that might've created some excitement that things were possible to break open that allowed the Terminal show later, the Times Square show later, the East Village later,
And I think also, Barnaby, I think we've changed the quality of, I think the Whitney Biennial in a way responded to us, because each year their shows have gotten in a way more diverse, more spread out over the country, and a little bit more addressing what they claim to address. You know, it's still not the show that people love, but it is a show that is now worthy, I think, of its name, perhaps.
That's really wonderful you say that, because I'm reminded of Bill Rabinovitch, who I thought was, I wouldn't say a perfect idiot, but he was definitely a shouting man who seemed to be trying things that were not possible and succeeding, which was surprising to me. And one of the things he said was, look, what was her name? Catherine Vanderbilt Whitney, whatever her name was. She was, it said that she'd started the Whitney Biennial in order to find the unknown artists and get their careers boosted. And they'd failed to do that because they were obviously moving everybody straight off the galleries. And so Bill's idea was eloquently mentioned by Bill was to, Rabinovitch is coming soon to talk to us. His idea was to get Gertrude Vanderbilt Whitney back into her true purpose, which was to let the Whitney reveal the underbase of the New York City art scene and the artists in America, really.
I'm wondering if we should start showing some of what we've done ourselves since then, so that we're not just only the Whitney counterweighters.
Good.
Doug? Where are you?
I'm right here. Whoops.
I'm coming Barnaby, back to make another appearance.
Should we start with Bill's video?
I was going to say, just in case Bill never shows up, let's show his video.
Let's go with Bill. Great idea.
All right, let me quickly share.
Go for it. There he is.
I was able to hear. If not, I'll reshare. Had a quick wrong.
No audio here. Heard here.
All right.
You know, with paintings like this, who needs the audio? I think it's looking great. I can even voice
over. No, I can. I can get the audio. It's just wasn't.
But this may be his only chance to say anything. So.
I think it's okay to start it, and when the audio comes, it comes.
That's easy for you to say.
I know. We'll see if I can screen share in a moment. I don't know. I tried,
Bill with this guy was with an enormous vision that for me showing up in New York City, thinking I was a competent person because of my naval officer experience. I thought I had some qualities, but I had no qualities. I was able to basically be a gopher, in case you're wondering, for Bill Rabinovitch and Vernita. And by the way, Vernita, the one thing I'm wondering about is, there we go. I think Vernita was actually also tempering Bill and also grounding our situation, which was overheated, but it worked.
There was a time. There was that time.
We can hear it, but we can't see it, Vanessa. A fleeting
moment in New York's memory.
We can hear it.
Oh, great.
Can't have everything.
We love that. Okay. Cut the audio.
I think if you can only have one, the visual will be more important.
Yeah, true.
Very odd that it's not letting me do that. It's frustrating. Sorry about that, team.
Why don't you keep working on it? And if it suddenly appears, then we'll just submit to it showing up. Keep working on it, and we'll keep talking. How's that?
Sounds good.
Okay, so we'll get back to Vernita.
What, Barnaby?
What do you remember that I forgot?
Well, I remember one time in Bill's gallery. I don't know why it happened, but for some reason there was some kind of battle going on. So I said, fuck it. I'm going to do something called a show within a show. And so I did this tiny little show in Rabinovitch and Guerra Gallery, where I invited everybody to have, you know, 4x6 cart size artwork. So maybe this is the precursor to your red boxes. I don't know. But then everybody brought in their work. You know, Carl Andre, Leon Golub, Nancy Spiro, all of these people. And to sign the work, I asked them to sign the wall with their signature for the artwork. And Jerry Talmer of the New York Post came down and saw the work, and David Hatchett happened to be there that day. And so David and I got our picture and all these little teeny artworks in the New York Post magazine as another rebellion against the Whitney Counterweight. And I think it's like just another example for any artist to think about how they want to get their work out there. You know, just do it. The more, you know, be creative, be crazy, be whatever, but get it out. That's the most important thing, is that other people see it, you know, and it's easier if you do it with other people and not by yourself.
I think Vernita's right. I'm realizing she was a missing link. And also, but by the way, the just do it idea was, I think in 76, I must tell you, the art world had a little bit of a depressed.
Ooh, Bill. Hi, Bill. Put your mic on. Put your mic on. Bill, put your mic on. You got to put your mic on, Bill.
Unmute.
We got him.
Yo, Bill.
Bill, microphone.
We've talked about you as the unsung hero.
Lower left. There you go. No. Lower left. Oh, it's so frustrating.
We'll get it.
Higher, a little bit to the left. Faster.
Microphone, Bill. It's on mute. I should be on mute.
There he is. Bill, you're on mute. There he is.
I know, we've got his face. Bill, if you don't start talking, we're just going to show your video.
Bill Page.
Yeah, he's been here all along.
Good one.
I guess. Bill, microphone, for heaven's sakes. Come on.
Maybe he can't hear you. I'm looking to put it in the notes. Direct message.
Okay, try that.
Okay.
I'm trying to do it too, but
Jackie Retta.
He looks like he's trying, but he's just not looking in the right place.
Can the host unmute?
Maybe we should try.
I only can request.
Running the recording.
Yeah, the host can unmute if you go to participants. You can unmute them.
I can only request to unmute.
Oh, that's right.
Oh, Doug.
Yes.
I mean, Bill. Unmute. Microphone. Unmute.
You got to write it down on a piece of paper? Yeah. Oh, somebody call him now. That'd be a good idea. Somebody phone him now.
Barnaby, try calling him again.
Yeah.
He'll never be able to read this because it's a terrible pen. Where'd he go? Where
Hold
is
it
he?
Up. Okay. Unmute. Unmut. Okay.
Did it say unmute mic?
Yeah. Okay.
God.
All right.
Let's go to Bill's video.
Let's show his video. Right.
Put on the video.
Give it an attempt.
Okay, let's try it again, Vanessa.
All right, I'm going to start with sharing. Then I will double share. Maybe that will do it.
Nice. Go for it.
Let me quickly share the
audio. And if you can't get sound, leave the sound off.
I think I figured it out. All right.
There it is.
There was a time.
But we don't see it.
There was that time.
I'm hoping that time will be this time.
Oh. Oh, here. I'll show you some of my paintings. Hello.
She's trying again.
Yeah.
That's good.
There we go. Okay.
Just do the video. They do the visual. That's great. That's perfect. There he is. That's perfect. It's like 1,000 words.
Street
it's God.
And the story we're about to tell has three locations. Crosby Street, Soho. A large warehouse in Delaware. And the artsiest artist apartment I've ever seen. So we sit with a now 87-year-old Bill in his old neighborhood to understand what it was like to be here. And it begins where most artists do, in the military.
So it started with NASA and the military, but they both wanted you to be a part of projects that you didn't necessarily believe in, so you kind of bounce out of there.
I decided to enlist in the Air Force. So I got to do my dream, which was to be able to be flying in a jet plane all by myself. They wanted me to fly B-47 bombers. And I just looked at them like, you know, really askance. And I went, there's no way I'm not going to do it. I bailed out of the program. And the next day I was out, I bought an old Volkswagen camper, drove off to the West Coast. It was before it all started. It was called the Hate Ashbury, becoming an artist and doing all these paintings. And ultimately, I noticed that more and more people were showing up. There was a lot of very, very heavy drug use. And while I enjoyed it all, I decided it wasn't the best place to start painting. Well, this woman, very well-dressed, walks in. Her name was Marcia Tucker. She said, Bill, I'm looking around at your paintings. And you've got to get to New York City as soon as possible.
Your use of color is incredible. Like, that's the first thing that pops out.
You're the guy. It was an instinctive thing early on.
Yeah.
To just give free vent to my emotional range, and that's the way it came out.
Through color. So your style of painting is extremely distinct. Did it just come from your soul, or are you influenced by people?
My hand wanted to do certain things in a certain way. And I just went, well, that seemed very natural to me because it was me. We were the only expressionist gallery in New York City. This was 1973. So I was sort of in a dangerous place, as Soho was then. There were very few people walking around. But at the same time, with all these giant lofts being emptied, it became a mecca for a different kind of artist.
This has to be crazy for you to be walking around Soho and see, like, Gucci and Prada and all these fancy stores and these million-dollar apartments, and they were like, that was my artist loft when nobody wanted to live here.
One day I was in my loft on Mercer Street. My landlady just flings open the door. Basically, I have someone who wants to rent your space. It was Ivanka Trump.
But being that Bill painted on the ground level of his loft, he often had fans and onlookers that would watch him work. Two fans in particular, named Andy Warhol and Jean-Michel Basquiat.
So when you were doing your thing, you were in your zone painting, and you look, and Warhol and Basquiat are there. Were you like, oh, hi?
I was really into what I was doing. I wasn't paying attention to what was going on.
Of course, right, yeah.
It's true. Basquiat was part of the scene.
Yeah.
It was before he became very famous. He was just a kid. He just went for it.
There.
And he really did it.
Every page is filled up with a sketch. Do you remember doing any of this?
Someday I would have a good day.
Right.
And someday I would have a bad day.
This looks like a good day.
That was pretty good.
You wouldn't sway to a more commercial
I wouldn't
place
do it.
Because
I,
you
had I just some... couldn't do it. Everything that I was doing in terms of my painting was coming out of my true inner fiber, my soul. See, it was in my character to be different. I don't know why that is exactly, but that's the way it turned out.
But like most mavericks, Bill was faced with his share of opposition. Like when the Whitney Museum was showcasing their selection of artists, mostly men, mostly all already well-known. So he decided to take them on. Along with a few friends, they created a show for everyone else. Women, minorities, up-and-comers, the anti-establishment show. They called it the Whitney Counterweight.
All the critics and everything said, you're going to fail, you're going down, it's never going to work. The day before it opened, the New York Times did a big feature article about it. And the next morning, at the opening hours, 15,000 people showed up.
At your place?
At my place. The show went on for about a month. And all the critics in New York, men and women, said that we were it.
So 1987, you got yourself a video camera and you started videotaping galleries and all these incredible pieces of art. And these are a lot of those, you still have those tapes.
It's hard for me to remember that I did so much. Mm-hmm. I was out every single week doing this stuff, and basically I was the only one doing it.
Right, you just loved art.
I just loved art. It was just, hey, I wanted to be in the middle of it, and I was.
Do you know what you're gonna be drawing right now? Do you have any idea?
No idea.
Do you want me to be nude? I'm willing for the art, but
that's the first laugh I've had in a long time.
Like, looking back at your life in art, do you wish you would have gone one way as opposed to another?
Pretty much I've stayed true to my deeper instincts. For better or worse, that's just been the nature of it.
You've been true to yourself as an artist forever.
It's been an adventure, because you never know what's going to happen the next day.
So, Bill, what we've done here in the past few minutes doesn't even come close to what you deserve. A man who's lived a life full of color and expression, whose truth lies before us in oil and pastel, on a wall, in a drawer, his style unwavering, as is his passion for the scene that once was. A time where art in New York was everywhere, and the word influencer actually had some artistic value to it. He represents the last of an era that lives on through the sketches in his books and the tapes in these bins. A lover of art, forever. A moment of New York, now gone by.
Oh my God.
That was great. That was great. Barnaby, why don't we see what you've been up to?
I'll give you some photos. Sure, why not? See if we can find some. There's one right there. And it's a accident, a portrait with a bit of abstraction going on. Hard to say. We have one here. Again, it's like a very strange thing. This is Barnaby Ruhe going through the Bardos. On his imminent death, this happens. It's obviously a strange thing, but the one I really need to show you right now is the Whitney Counterweight. This one here is Alice Neal's portrait of me back in 81. Whoa, it's gone. Here we go. Find it again. There it is. Got it again. Okay, now this is the Alice Neal. Bill basically got Alice and Elaine de Kooning and Aristodemus Caldas in 81 to do some acetates, some prints, so we could sell them for making, you know, the event go. We were always scrounging for money and succeeding. And this was one reason, because of the glory of having these extraordinary artists. 81-year-old Alice Neal saw me and decided to paint my portrait right there. Took about 15 minutes, I must say. She was extraordinarily direct. It was like shocking to see the way she would throw the paint down. And without any hesitation. That was just quite something. And of course, I had to date her for about a year after that, meaning take escorting her around town. My most fun thing there was taking her to Aristodemus Caldas lecture. And I said, well, Alice, you know, you're the most famous person. You should go to the front row. And she said, I can't go to the front row with Aristodemus. He pinches. She still remembers, you know, 50, 60 years earlier when, you know, she was a babe, I guess. But that, why wouldn't they? And this is my Genesis painting right here, which is a fairly large abstraction. Although it does have a little moment in the very center, you might almost begin to see it. It's a little note I took to myself that basically said, in the beginning was the word, and the word was girl, and she wrestled with snake, the earth came from chaos for fun, and she ate the apple, and she was that damn smart. So what happened was the Genesis is just simply something that needs to be rewritten and revised. And that's what the artists have to do. They have to take action and just simply go back to the beginning and make something happen. And I quit. What have you got, Vernita? Give us some
paint. Okay, thank you. Let me see if I can do it. Share screen. Okay. Oh, there. All right. That's where I want to go. Okay. What I'm going to show you is my last show, I hope. Fuck. Yeah. Good. This was my last show at Soho 20 Gallery, which was that same year that we started doing the counterweights, 1977, 78. And I was doing installations at the time. I had painted the whole gallery humorette orange, the color of humorette ice cream bars. And then I drew on paper that was the same color. And I did a performance using that as a set. Here's a couple of other views of it. And I filled the gallery. It was my last solo show there.
And Vernita, you gotta double click on the item so it goes large. I see a tiny picture.
Oh, okay. Let me go back and see if I can do that. Ooh, is that better?
No.
I didn't think so.
Can you double click on the item? Can you just click on the image itself? It's one
is that better? How's that?
I don't think you have the whole screen shared. You might just have the application.
Yeah.
So I would suggest resharing and just allowing the full screen.
Okay, let's see.
You have to unshare.
I'll stop share. Then,
yeah.
Okay, go back to share.
We apologize for the technical issues on this call we've had.
There they are.
How's that?
There we go.
There you go.
Okay.
There you go.
Okay, so now you can see it. I continued doing installations at the Jersey City Museum, at Soho 20, at various places. And I was so proud because what I was doing then was the beginning of my detritus shows in actuality, because all of these fragments of fabric and photographs and things were things left over from other art shows that I had done and other artworks. And if I'm not mistaken, I put this piece, this installation, on a large background paper. And I think that was shown in one of the counterweight shows on West Broadway. And it's, as you can see, it's sort of a landscape. And I seem to be involved with landscapes, fabric, stuff, sculpture at the time. And these were all quite large. There I am, a young woman, in one of my first artworks called The Box of Crayons, The Box of 64. And I had found all the colors of the 64 crayons in taffeta. And here again, you see the scraps of all the leftovers that I created an installation from. And this was in the back room of Soho 20. I guess there's another view of it. And I wanted to show you one other thing, if I can. Let's see, how can I do this? Let me see if I can go to... I don't know if I'm going to be able to do this. I guess I can't... I wanted to show you my current work, but I don't think I can figure it out. You're seeing my whole file here. You might be in there.
Yeah, right? We are. That's what we're seeing.
Yeah, yeah. Let me see. It's not going to work. I know. This was, okay, forget it. That's it. Oh, ooh, there you are. There's my whole life.
We're not seeing it.
You're not seeing it?
You got to double click and share that screen again. You got to, okay. I mean, you got to you got to unshare and share that screen where you see the large one.
I don't think I can do it. That's all. That's enough of me.
And let's see if we can get Bill to speak. Can Bill Rabinovitch figure out what unmute is? Unmute, Bill. Rabinovitch.
It's unmuted.
Hey. Yes, can you hear me now?
I hear you.
I can hear you now.
Hi, Bill. Talk to us.
Well, I just
what were you
wanted
thinking
to,
about? What were you thinking about attacking the Whitney Biennial? What was your thinking?
You madman.
Well, okay, here's what I'm thinking. Okay, you can hear this, right?
Yes. Yep.
All right. So today there was a some great news, and it said something that the current Whitney Biennial wasn't attracting any audience at all. Okay, now you got to keep in mind that this was on April 1st. And so what they decided to do was to open up the Whitney Biennial again to more revolutionary art, which is a point that I made when I wrote about this a couple of weeks ago. And they're going to invite revolutionary artists because the art that they're showing is not controversial in any way. It's tepid. That's the way the New York Times described it. And so
I thought it
was a chance for some of us to submit something to the Whitney Biennial. They have a new date, May something or other, that you have to submit a thing by. And it has to be really controversial. That's the whole issue. And they said they said it would be part of the exhibit. And I said, apparently they'll take the rest of the exhibit down because it's not drawing any kind of crowd. Now, that's what we did during the Whitney Counterweight. We had extraordinarily dynamic art, very powerful, very interesting. And that's why Grace Gluck, the night before the Whitney Counterweight opened in Soho, she said that we were it. And that's why 15,000 people showed up the next day. And although everyone said we were going to fail, it was the Whitney that got no reviews at all. And we basically had every critic in New York, men and women, and all the newspapers and media on our side, because we had something called much better artists that had an edge to them. No, I don't say every single one.
You know, yeah, even though we did pick by slides, there was also the way in which the shows were enhanced because we hung the shows. So you put up, we featured Nancy Spiro, Leon Golub, David Hammons. Was that, I keep getting.
Alice Neal.
Huh? Yes, Alice Neal. Oh my God. So we had, that's no wonder they went crazy, because the underground artists we were featuring were like everybody knew. They're screaming, why don't the galleries have these, like Leon Golub, Nancy Spiro, Alice Neal, we're not getting the good galleries yet. So it was a really great deal. And babe, Bill, my question is, how come you knew all this? Your eyes were around the art world. And I keep remembering you mentioning, I got this artist like David Hammons, you're not going to believe it. Like, in other words, you actually knew these, you knew who needed to be in the show. Of course, they got through the slide committee their quality.
Yeah, they were. Yeah, we had a bunch of really great artists who have continued to be famous. And the Whitney just had the same old establishment artists that were already millionaires, I presume. And there were hardly any women artists. There were no minority artists.
Women artists were one out of ten at most. Yeah.
We had manifestos that were quite good. And if I knew how to manipulate the slides that I had lined up, I could show you the Whitney Counterweight catalogs, what they looked like, the covers, and some of the names of some of the artists. And presumably we can add that after this is all over, because now I've got still frames of all this very interesting historical material. Now,
yes, please.
I will say that we did another, in 2014, there was this fellow named Flashlight, who was a good friend of most of us, who ran a website called the Whitney Counterweight. And he put it up, and it was all the historical stuff about what happened in 1977 and since then. And so we had an internet based one in 2014. Now, Flash, unfortunately, was a victim of COVID and he passed away. And the website, I really don't know how to resurrect it, although I may be able to get pieces of it back up. But it's definitely a thing to do to try. I'll try to get some of the historical photographs and all the names of the people who participated in the various Whitney Counterweights up, so it will carry a kind of historical resonance up through today.
One thing I just wanted to add is I think part of the difference, again, and maybe we've said this 100 times already, is that the Whitney was always knew the artists that it wanted to have in that show and knew the dealers that they wanted to approach. Whereas we were very, very open and we were searching. We were constantly searching for new art, new ideas, new people, because we wanted to know them as well.
Yeah. Yeah, we succeeded.
Yes.
In that sense. There were artists from all over the United States that we had that really didn't have a huge background, because we judged the whole thing by slides. You couldn't tell if the slide was from a man or a woman. It was
right.
Completely based on what the work really, really did look like. And that made a huge difference. Whereas the Whitney was going with names. And,
we have just 3 minutes left.
They've got to get back into, the Whitney has got to get back into a real new kind of framework of mind, which is to not be fearful of controversial work. Now this thing that they put out today, that they're searching for new artists, even though the biennial is open. It might have been an April Fool's Day joke, but there was a lot of consensus on Facebook that it was real. And so they aren't getting the crowds, so their place is going to basically remain empty for a couple of months. And at least that's what this thing implied. And so
what Bill is basically, what I hear Bill saying is that any artist group can obviously muscle with great effort getting some gallery spaces at the right time in the right place. But the reason we have an advantage over the museum scale situations is because we can actually go for the punch.
Yeah.
Does anybody have any questions, any comments? Doug,
I was going to say that there's the Soho Memory Project, and that would be a good place to recap, the history of the counterweight and the artists that were in it and so on. Basically create an article for that project.
Good.
The other thing I wanted to jump in and say, one of the things Artists Talk on Art did is we had on March 18th, 1977, we had a program called Whitney Counterweight, a symposium. Barnaby was the moderator, and it featured Gilbert Coker, Vernita Nemec, Gregory Reeve, Bill Rabinovitch, and
Patterson Sims from the Whitney,
who had curated the Whitney.
Right.
So that panel, as far as I know, the audio, I think it probably would be audio tape at that point, but might have been video.
Audio.
Documented.
It would be audio only.
So, yeah, we had talked earlier about trying to get that out again into public view or public ears. But
there is a video
here all night.
There is a video already on the internet. It's been there for a long time on YouTube, of a documentary that a local college made of the 1981 Whitney Counterweight. Mm-hmm. And it's about a half hour long. It does a walk around all around the show.
Bill names all the artists.
Yeah, showing every artist. And in the beginning of it, there's an introduction where Vernita and myself and Barnaby were interviewed for about 10 minutes, and then it got right into the artwork of everything that was submitted and all the five different spaces that we were in that year, all around Soho.
Yeah, so that's a great.
It's quite a good document. And at the end of the document, we had a, called a waltzing ball on Broome Street in a very large space, where hundreds of people showed up to be in this waltzing ball, and there were performances. And
he was teaching everybody how to waltz.
Yeah.
That was astonishing. It was a waltzing ball and punk. At midnight, it turned into Sex Pistols from the Blue Danube.
Yeah, it was a fabulous, the video is pretty good, and it's still right up there, and it answers a lot of the questions of why we did it and how come we were so successful. The local newspaper, the Soho News, was 100% behind us, and all the major newspapers in New York, besides the Critics, were on our side also. And curiously, they really didn't say anything about the Whitney Biennial itself. They just let it sort of pass as...
I wonder why no one has done it since, actually.
Well, we did a slight one, an internet-based one in 2014. And if I can resurrect Flash's website, there are quite a few, there are about 50 artists who are part of that. But it was a difficult thing to do, and it didn't have the real touch of existing in a real space, or in real spaces like the Counterweight did. And it sort of didn't really get any publicity. So I think there is a chance, if we were able to resurrect something in the next couple of weeks, as the Whitney Now Biennial is calling for new art, new controversial art. I can't believe they actually use those words, but it was on an article by allergenic. There's another first word.
Hyperallergenic.
Yeah, and if you look at their website, you'll see this.
Now I know what you're talking about, Bill. So, that whole hyperallergic thing you saw, which I saw as well, is a put on. The whole thing was an April Fool's issue. It's
well, that's what most people said. However,
yeah, it's not real, nice thought.
Well, you know what? I think that we should take them as the truth and maybe try to do that show. Okay. So if any of you guys have the energy, let's do it.
Okay. Someone watching, Klaus watching, said, how do you find that video from 1977 on YouTube?
Search for Whitney Counterweight.
That's it? Okay.
I think that'll do it.
If you do a Google search on Whitney Counterweight, there are two videos that will come up. One is from 1977 with a talk show that invited myself and Elizabeth Converse to speak with a very sophisticated guy about why we did the Whitney Counterweight. And there's another, and then there's the video that was done by the local college about 1981. Mm-hmm. And there was even a third video that came up the other day when I did a new search. So there's plenty of stuff. Now, as far as this being April Fool's Day and what the Whitney said, the article was very cleverly put together. Didn't seem like joke.
So, Bill, it wasn't the Whitney. It was the magazine Hyperallergic. And it was an April Fool's. It was one item out of about 20 items. They were all, pure jesting. Wasn't real.
Well, they gave us an entryway.
It did.
A lot of sympathetic.
I think we should do it.
And I think we should do it.
Good for them.
So yep. can I bring in a little idea here, which is, you know, the entire counterweight, all the artists that were involved, the all of the you folks that were the, you know, protagonists, this should be in some collection somewhere. There should be material about it organized into some archive. And I think, am I correct, Vernita, that you're intending to send things to Archives of American Art yourself, right?
Yep.
So, you know, one of you or all of you should be contributing materials as you understand them, as you have them, in whatever way you can, to Archives of American Art or any other archive, the NYU archive at the, you know, the library there.
Soho Memory Project.
Hmm?
Soho Memory Project.
The Soho Memory Project, exactly. But somebody, or more than somebody, you know, multiple people, should put what they know somewhere so it doesn't completely get lost.
I've actually got the original red box from 1983 with 100 original paintings in it, an extra copy.
Like that. So, yeah,
perfect. Let's
do
it.
The catalog, the calendar, the poster, the boxes, all of those things.
Let's do it.
Okay. Yeah, if there is a possibility of being able to, at least in part, resurrect what Flashlight had put together, which was rather magnificent. It was it had newspaper articles that were in it, and it had the names of all the artists by name and the different counterweights, and it had a lot of historical information that led up to the counterweight. Now, I will say one thing. One of my reasons for wanting to do this in the first place, it's a little anecdotal, but I was living in San Francisco and Marcia Tucker walked into my studio from the new museum. She said, Bill, you got to get to New York for the Whitney program. So I did. And what happened was, it was a time of the minimalists and conceptualists were still the primary artists group in New York City. And what they were invited in to give us the symposiums that they gave. And if they saw anybody painting like me, for example, they would just make fun of us right there in the symposiums. And these were the superstars of the minimalist conceptual movement. And so instead of like quitting right there as being attacked by the great gods, I decided to attack them verbally right there at the time. But that set off a lot of problems. Like the Whitney Museum wanted to throw me out of the program for confronting them, for example. And that went on. They finally weren't successful, but they tried really hard. And it was it just showed you how artist groups can be against each other. And that is the exact way that a lot of individuals, they find their own voices, because by taking an oppositional attitude toward people they think are famous and stuff like that, they become more intelligent and witty, and their art will prosper. Now, one of the big problems today is that all the art is made under the auspices of intense capitalist motives. In other words, it's to make a profit. And it has changed the aesthetics of the art world into a kind of like a dumb art forms where the artists, if they hit on something that really works, they will just do it for the end of their lives. They'll get a whole team of 50 people as studio assistants and they will crank them out. But as far as being a real artist, that's all sort of disappeared this day in the way that things are run. And so
Bill is creating another countervision in 2024 as we speak.
Yeah. Yeah. I think we should do something this year on the alternative date of the counterweight, which is you know, there is 2024, but even if ours opens a little later, I think that we can, I mean, where did they ever have anyone like Kusi Masuda?
Oh my God.
And I think we should thank Hyperallergic for inviting us to do it.
Yes.
Yeah.
What a great idea.
We could turn this to our advantage. It's only going to take a little bit of imagination and getting hold of some space. I'm sure, just like we did the counterweight, all the spaces that we got were donated. Ivan Karp sort of, I went over to talk to Ivan Karp of OK Harris one day, and I said, we want to do the counterweight. And he said, well, what have you got for a space? And I said, well, we have my space, Rabinovitch and Guerra Gallery. He said, no, you need more spaces, and I'm going to find them for you. Now, good Ivan Karp was like the mayor of Soho, and he came up with all the spaces inside a few days, and we were able to just march ahead. And maybe the same kind of thing could happen again, not with Ivan Karp, who's long gone, or Leo Castelli, who's long gone, or Andy, who was very, very friendly to us and supportive of me. So it's kind of like we're throwing the cards up into the air right now, and how they land would indicate how we might be able to move forward on this and have it really, have it really happen in this year. And I already know someone who has already expressed interest, but he thought that we were talking about 2026. No, we're talking about 2024. We could do something this year, and it could be like an explosion. The artwork would be great. I'm sure, I'm fairly certain the New York Times would get behind us again, you know, if we could manage to do something. But I'm creating kind of like a, hoping to create a little bit of a stir here in this, but I'm very happy to join in with it and put in whatever energies I have.
Now you know how Bill thinks. Now you know how we did this. I'm glad Bill is speaking. Otherwise, no one could figure out how the counterweight could have ever happened. It's because this guy starts talking and suddenly a new world is possible.
Yeah, it's possible. And it, like everyone said before the first counterweight, if you do it, you're finished. And it will never happen. It'll fail. That's what a lot of the critics said to me. But the day before, with the New York Times article, reality totally changed. It took one article to change reality, and we were it. We were the kingpins of Soho and all of New York City. And the exhibit went on for about 3 weeks. So it was really, really something. And I think we could only do better these days. So I'm just throwing it out there.
Yeah, and if any of you guys have ideas about spaces that might become available, and you yourself as an artist are interested in participating and bringing in more artists, like, get in touch with Bill, Barnaby, or myself.
Oh my God, I feel it.
Okay, I'm gonna use this opportunity to thank you all, Barnaby, Vernita, and Bill, for sharing all these thoughts about the counterweight from 40 years ago and even longer, and the same spirit tonight. I really appreciate that. And I thank Vanessa for being our Zoom host tonight.
Vanessa.
I thank you all for coming and spending time with us tonight.
Thank you, Jeff.
Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Inviting us.
Look forward to seeing you again soon.
Thanks. Yeah.